Minds, we're at the New England Haunt Show. Oh yeah. So I taught a class at 11 o'clock and I'm teaching one at 7 o'clock. In the meantime, I'm going to go through some of the vendors, talk to some people, get on a video. Now my son videotaped the first class. You can hear a lot of it. Sound isn't the greatest, but I think you might be able to learn something on the same. And so we finished with the Haunts for Hunger yesterday here, and then we're heading to Londonderry to do some hot escape room action here shortly. So that'll be tomorrow. Enjoy the video. Please subscribe. And hey, check out these vendors. Check out the show. Appreciate you watching. Already in session.
Yeah. I was always told nobody would ask questions. And then I'm like at a half hour or so, about 50 minutes in, I sit there and said they may have any questions. And the whole place was like 100 people in there. So I said to Bobby, look, let's just make it a Q&A because I can speak to my heart's content, but I may not come across with your situation or your needs or anything like that. So let's just start off with basically, any question answered you want about any UV applications, 3D, invisibles, phosphorescence, glow in the darks, anything of that nature as far as anything, propping, murals, etc. So, who wants to go first?
What do you use for invisibles?
Invisibles, wildfire. Okay, now brace yourself. Your wildfire, your blue, and your wildfire white are about 145 a gallon. Okay? They need to be placed on a white surface. You cannot paint them on a black surface. When you want to get into your colors, your yellows are pretty decent. Greens are $600 a gallon, reds are $1,200 a gallon. They cannot be used with LED lights. Wildfires can only be, the only wildfires will show up underneath LED are the white and the blue. Anything else will just be muted. The LEDs, they have them marking on top. this neck of the woods, you're still having Trump problems with the T-12s. Where are you guys from?
Virginia.
Virginia. Yeah. And you get T-8s or T-12s?
The 12s are the big balls.
And the T-8s are the little balls.
We have both. We do find the bigger ones.
Okay. Because in my neck of the woods, you can still buy them too. So whenever I see them, I've been buying them up. I don't even know what it is. And,
I think most of ours are secondhand, honestly.
Okay. So if you ever want to do invisibles, which is a great effect, for instance, you visit their painted mural and then introduce invisibles into that mural. And so you have a strobe light going, and this strobe is going this way, keeping your black light on at all times, since you can't strobe the 4 foot tube to a burn them out. But if you have a strobe going, and I suggest a colored strobe rather than white, because white will screw around people's eyeballs. So an amber is very cool, a blue is very cool, and you'd be able to just have that thing transition back and forth. And the more you do that, your mural now has become a prop because it looks like it's going to be closer and closer to you every time it flashes. So it's just not a mural anymore. Now it's the walls are alive. Same thing, almost in the same vein, creating different colors with your UV paints. If you want to create browns and tans and different colors other than all the vulgar eyeballs out with reds and greens, you can add orange and green, red and green in varying stages, and you will get browns and tans and sand colors that look cool in ambient light, but then will blow up when the block light hits. So again, people walk into a room, you might have it segmented in an octagonal way, and all these images are coming in and out. So instead of them just walking in and, oh gee whiz, look at that, it's cool, 3D glasses and stuff, you actually have your murals come alive. Okay. So, did that.
So you use the blue and the white on white paint only?
Any of the invisibles have to be on white.
Like gray work?
Gray, okay. But black, no. The one thing about wildfire is crappy paint, okay? They have great binders, the great pigments, but the binder is no good, okay? Whereas day glow shoots like automotive colors, but they don't create an invisible, okay? The only way you can do that is you actually can buy pigments from day glow that are invisible, because they supply the pigments for wildfire, all right? But it's difficult finding a clear clear binder. Now, I tried to buy some of the binder from Dago. That they have a clear binder, they would not sell it to me. Okay. Actually, no, the binder, anytime you go to the store, if I sit there and buy pigments from the store, I want to get the clearest binder I can find without the titanium white. And so I go down to Salvation Army or Goodwill and buy me a $15, $10 blender. And I'll add that in with a binder, Floetrol, and the pigment, okay? And add a touch of vinegar. If you add a little vinegar in, it keeps bacteria from building up inside the paint. So if it sits for long periods of time, you guys open it, possibly introduce paint that you'd mix back in the gallon, the vinegar will keep any bacteria from building up. So.
You clear coat over the...
Do not clear coat over any of the visibles. Anything that puts you between that artwork, between the black light, will destroy it. Okay, if you want your wildfire and everything like that, your invisibles to be stronger, add in a binder into the paint. So there's something called Microspersion 31. You can get that through rosebrand.com. Microspersion. I always said dispersion. I said that wrong. I said it's actually Microspersion 31. It's $9 a small tub of it, and one tub to 1 gallon of paint. So what I do is I'll take that, mix a heavy portion of that into the water I'm using to mix my paints. And this is an extra hardener that goes on areas on Broadway where they have all the ballet dancers and like that. And it just puts a hard coating into the paint without changing the formula of the paint. So it's not going to give it a sheen or anything of that nature. There is also polyacrylic can be mixed in. That is a water-based polyurethane, and that's put in Minwax, so you can pick that at Home Depot or Lowe's, or professional grade spar urethane, and that is a yellow and black can from Minwax as well. And that can be picked up at Home Depot, Lowe's, Menards.
Or they Minwax what, poly?
Polyacrylic, and then there's the water-based spar urethane. And I suggest at least mid gloss or gloss. Now you're not going to see gloss in the black light, but the more glosser is, the more partners there are. Where you're adding into the paint, and that works for all the Daglos too. Daglo wildfire doesn't matter. That works in mixing into all of your UV paints, so you're not putting a topical on it. That's going to cause a distraction from the black light. So I mean, anytime you put a clear coat, I knew, did this whole scene in a bar, and it was gorgeous. The customer, when he left, sat there and went and got the Day-Glow clear coat and blasted all the walls with it. When he came back in, they turned the black light on, he went, bye-bye. Okay? Because it's meant to protect against UV. And he was like, hello! So.
what about the black? Kind of black use, is that
okay? Actually, customers usually use, but I usually say at least eggshell. Okay. Satin, okay. Sometimes I've done semi-gloss, and that's bad because the black light will reflect off. And in a perfect world, you want the black lights. You don't want the chintzy LEDs that shows all your work, you know? Part of the fantasy of your black light situation is that your structure goes bye-bye and black becomes negative. So that's why I've always liked the 4-foot tubes rather than the LEDs. But customers put on what they want, but we want the decent ones that won't show all the seams and screw holes and gee whiz, you know, sometimes construction's pretty bad where I can hand tools to the guy across the way because it gave me gaps and it's, you know, it's like, you know, I didn't say nothing, you know, and I'm just here to paint, you know, like so. Yeah, your exterior, I use exterior on everything. Especially the fact that I'm honest with you, doing heavy portions of fog, humidity, a lot of the places do not have AC, and you're gonna want something that's gonna be a little bit more leafy than, and it's not that much more to get exterior than it is an interior.
Oh, it's black exterior that you use?
Now, detail-wise, with my small airbrush, I use Rust-Oleum's oil-based flat block. Okay? I ran out of the high end airbrush foo-foo paint one time at a job site in the middle of the night, and I was in trouble. And that was about 15 years ago. And there was a panel of Rust-Oleum flat black in there with some metal springs. I tried that on and went back for a $9 can of that. I can do three sites. I might use 4 little jars, 3 ounce jars to detail the entire thing. And you're gonna save yourself a whole bunch of money because that equivalent in the airbrush paint for about $40. Okay, and that's just a waste of money. This is a hard coating, shoots to the gun real nice, lubricates the gun at the same time. Okay, and it's a lot easier to clean out than the waterways. If you forget to clean up your gun one night, you're gonna be in big trouble the next day. So.
That was
Rust-Oleum's flat back. Yeah, Rust-Oleum flat back. It comes in quarts. I usually buy it by the quart rather than the gallons. Gallons get messy after a while. Just buy a quart here, a quart there.
Stuart, I think we're unlike a lot of places here because we also have the ground done. In most places, you know, or outdoors, might not have the ground done. Is there a different coating that you use for the ground? Because
that ground, lives.
It's like it doesn't peel at all. It's amazing.
Right. The coatings I discuss, the spar urethane, the microspersion 31 and stuff, these are things you place into the paint so you don't have to put a clear coat. So when these guys had me do this, I sat there and painted the floor a real nice heavy coat of black. Okay? Then, sometimes, if it's cement, I'll go buy Rust-Oleum's water-based cement stain right off the shelf, no tint. I'll add that into the black paint, and then I coat that. What it does is it etches into the concrete, okay? Gives you a hard coating already, because the worst part about it is the job I was just at, they're using particle board. Okay, it was already human. They said, well, the walls were free. I said, well, free's not always a good thing, okay? And so, I don't care what hardness you put in the paint. First and foremost, what are we painting? Okay, and that's the most important thing. Then, we add in, if it's cement, we add in the coating. If it's wood, sometimes a smaller area, I'll go through with the Zinsser white primer to give it a good coat. Then I'll sit there and put in the exterior black. Okay, make sure she's on there good. Even if it takes a day to dry, make sure you got a great, you know, coating. And then we'll add in the spar urethane and our microspersion 31 into all the paints. Okay, and then they're rushing out that way. Especially, you probably want to use, you know, here we don't have to worry about the guys tracking in dirt. You know, like some of the job sites we've done where they're, you know, at Liberty, dirt everywhere, and they're tracking on in, paint is just going to grit and grind on the floor. So you might put a mat out saying, hey, the ghosts appreciate the fact that you just clean your shoes up. You know, don't break character, just have a nice little sign, and there you go.
We're also lucky because it's the last of the three attractions, so if they are coming in with any, you know, mutter, there isn't, because we're indoor, it's very unlikely,
right,
as opposed
right.
to, you know, wooded places and all that. By the time they've reached that third haunt, I mean, there's no way there's any gook on their shoes.
Right, yeah, we're good. And you know, the other thing, too, this is the way where you'd be able to sweep a vamp mopper floor. Right, the paint's that good, you can mop it, take care of everything. You're going to want to mop it in the black light, not the white light, because people come through and paint in the white light, and then all of a sudden, they missed a whole bunch of spots because they weren't doing it in the black light. You'd want to clean your floor in the black light and make sure you got it well. Stuart Smith, nice to meet you there, sir.
Hi, Melissa. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. So, next question.
PSI on your balance?
70. I shoot a 70 PSI. You guys want to shoot the day glow, crystal, and stuff like that. You got to forget about this 45 PSI thing. You need to learn trigger control on your airbrushes. And shoot 70-80 PSI. When I was in Indonesia, I had to shoot at 120 because they didn't have regulators. So trigger control is the way to sit there and control that. It doesn't matter what pressure is behind that gun. You need to be able to control it. I use a Pasha VL number 3 is my go-to gun. I have about 40 of them. And that is a double-action airbrush. And it doesn't matter the pressure behind. And I also use at least a 20 to 30 gallon compressor. No, none of these little putt-putts. All right, that way you've got all the pressure behind your gun. And I also shoot, even though it says 10 PSI on the gravity feed spray guns, I shoot those at 70 as well. Okay, just make sure you keep the hole on top exposed so you don't blow the cap off. That's happening. My wife's in the other room. I come on, I'm just coding. You know, it's, you know, safety first, you know.
Yeah.
Is this?
What about painting on canvas?
Mm-hmm.
Painting on canvas?
I use heavyweight muslin. Doesn't matter if it's flame retardant or not. And if I have a black, I'll put the primer on first, and you can use a zinzer right on the primer. It does not peel. Because the beautiful thing is I'm not sizing it. I am spraying through the fibers, and it's catching on the fibers. Then, my colors. If I go with a white canvas, I don't even bother with the primer. I just paint it, and it shoots through the canvas. It's got the reflectiveness of the white behind it coming back, and it's good to go. Then they can be folded and stored away rather than rolled. Okay, and they'll pop out. And a lot of times what I'll do when I do a canvas is I'll finish it up and I'll spend 15 minutes with a kerosene heater just blowing on it, just to soak it in and have it all dry in those fibers. And then I got canvases from 20 years ago still floating around that people are still using. So
do you ever shoot like on white and then like kind of take black and just, you know, black out whatever?
Oh yeah. Now the one drawback to canvas is once you have paint on a certain area, it is difficult to get the black to make the UV go away. So be strategic as to where you place your colors. Leave the raw canvas there, and then where you want black, that's where you paint. Like I might do a huge image in the middle of 8x8. Then before I even detail it, I will black out that whole area. Make sure that is very dry before you do any of your ghosting. When I was talking about ghosting, the day glow, you can sit there and use your little airbrush. You don't need a white thing. You can sit there and have a hard image in the center and then move out. And also, when you report here beforehand, save yourself time and money. Make sure you use primer first. Then put your UV on top of it. And you'll save yourself a lot of money. One coat, you're done.
You were saying you use a Zinzer's primer?
Zinzer primer, yeah, 3-2-1 bullseye. Yep. Yep, that works fantastic.
Do you go straight out of the can or do you get that tinted?
No, straight out of the can. So white.
So you prefer white background?
Yeah. Well, paint the thing black where I want an image, then I'll spray it out. Okay, and then put my image there. So we call that the heart image. So a big, big monster in the center. And then when I want to expand on it. But if you put the sensor down first, it's a one-time deal. There's a seat right there, sir, if you want to grab that.
Oh, I'm
right here, yeah.
Yeah. I have a problem with hearing, so I got to...
Oh, okay. Well, get right here then, sir.
Yeah, find out which
Yeah. Well, I got a boomy voice anyways, I'm too old, so...
Okay. So what happens when you get old.
Yeah, I understand that. I just want hair growing out of my shoulder. It gets about that long every year. And clip it back, you know. I know. So, primer is your friend, right? So, you know, instead of caking it, when I'm doing it, I want red in this particular area. I put the primer down, I got the red in the spray gun, I got one coat, and I'm done. So if I have a set of 10 to 15 gallons of paint, I can do 3 or 4 or 5 projects with that. We've covered 20,000 square feet. $1,000 invested in paint. Whereas some people have spent $1,300, $1,500 of the paint and they're doing one project because they put somebody on it that really didn't know what they were doing and are just caking it. Well, it's not bright enough, it's not coming through. It's like, well, because these simple things, your $13 gallon of primer versus your $140 gallon of paint. Okay. Neat thing though, too, if you want to sit there and make different blues, Zinsser has a profuse amount of titanium white in it. You can make all the varying blues with that by mixing it with the blue from the day glow. A lot of times, because I'm working with other people, I can't work underneath the block light because other construction people are doing their thing. So if I want to see what I'm doing, I will add blue into the white. And that way I can see better what's going on. Also, if I have to do a bunch of stuff, I can see a lot better because if you're spraying the day glow in a white tank thing, it's very difficult until it's dry to see what you've done. Add a little primer in there and you go to town. Like if you have people working out during the day, they'd be able to work, place a little bit of white in some of the colors so they can see that they've actually applied.
You said Zinsser? Is that the
Zinsser.
I didn't know them for stain kill.
Oh, they said 3-2-1 bowls of it.
Yeah.
It is great primer.
Yeah, okay. Because it's dry, you're good to go.
Yep.
And you can add stuff to it, then
you can add some of the UV cuts. If you want differing type of colors, like if you want a varying degrees of blue, so your horizon blue from day one comes out very dark, very bright, but if you want to sit there and create different layers of blue, you can add a little of that white to it. Like you can set up 3 or 4 different containers and say, I got an ounce of white, 2 ounces, 3 ounces, 4 ounces, and then add your blue accordingly, and then you can create all different venues.
That's the oil base in
it. No, it's water base.
The oil base.
Water base.
The water base in it, yeah. And they already make 3.
Yep.
Alcohol,
yep.
Oil, and water.
They also make that ceiling paint.
Oh, yeah.
Which is great for the invisibles. Now, in Londonderry, about 3 hours from here, I did an invisible escape room. So basically, you go in, the control mechanism is there, you have X amount of time to rid the world of the evil, okay, before it happens. And what we did is I came in, they painted it with the ceiling paint. Then I put down the invisible whites and blues, and then I detailed it with the ceiling paint. So white on white on white. Okay, when the black light's on, all the monsters and wickedness are all over the place. They're finally done, and as the lights kept on coming on, and the black lights kept on fading as they were solving the puzzle, the whole room went back to white.
Wow.
Okay. And the reason why we want to use the same corresponding color as the base coat is if your paint that you're detailing with has any different sheen, when the black light's gone and the white light's on, you'll see outlines. Okay. And that's what you want to avoid. Because I did one just with flat black. And you can see all the outlines. So I had to come in at 4 o'clock in the morning, repaint it, and do it with the other stuff, and then it all disappeared. So, I was discussing with these guys before you came in. You could literally do invisible paints. You could have an image there. You could have the invisibles all around it, white, and then you could sit there. no longer a mural, that was a prompt. Okay. You may add sound effects to it.
Wait, which way are you hitting the strobe? Are you hitting the strobe straight on or sideways?
It depends. Okay, we just don't want it in the eyes of the client. Okay, so if I'm walking forward towards a gentleman taking the camera, I'd want the strobe up here. I want the black lights up here. You don't want them in the eyes of the client. Number one, it destroys the fantasy. Number two, the strobe goes off. Possibly they might be wearing 3D glasses. It causes issues. Okay, you don't need 3D glasses for this application. So, I mean, you could do a whole maze of just nothing but invisible applications and things of that nature and not even purchase 3D glasses. Okay, you could have all different colors and stuff, but it would have the illusion, especially if you have a hard, if you did a hard ambient painted image with a white background and the image behind is painted in the invisibles, it's gonna make that visible pop forward. Just the shiny strobe going up. Okay, and you can set it where it's just pouncing all over that wall, or just have it just a steady boom. It all depends on what you want to do. You might have this one over here going at this speed, this one over here going at another speed, and it would just disorient your clients very much. But all this cool artwork coming out, but it's all doing different things. You can introduce black light into it. You can have strobe, you can have white strobe, color strobes, and then black light. It all depends on how you want to set it up. You have a lot of fun with it.
Will gels work on the screen?
Oh, yeah.
For the colors?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, gels. I'm partial to amber. Okay. I think amber is, it's got that kind of nasty color to it. I think it works out well. But a nice deep purple works real good, too.
That would be your base tone?
Yeah. Well, we were discussing, base, your base coat, we were discussing before you got here, an invisible application. So let's say I wanted to paint a mural, but I want the invisibles included with it. So I'm going to paint a mural in just regular UV paints, but I'm going to mix them. So I'm going to take red and green, or orange and green, orange, blue and green, and create sand colors and all these different browns,
right,
rather than you blow yourself out of the can things. Then the white in the background, I come along with invisible white or invisible blue, and I've created a whole mirror on the back. Right.
That's man-made engine
or no? No, that's your wildfire white and blue. Okay. For about 140 a gallon. Okay. But what I do is I will spray it on in layers with an automotive spray gun in the image I want, then I'll detail it out with the background color that I put on. So we use a ceiling paint from Zinsser, then I'm gonna detail it out, so we're painting white on white on white. Now when the black light hits, the white turns black. Okay, but it won't show up until the black lights are on. So when we introduce a strobe, that comes forward. Your image in the front will look cool in black light. It's gonna go into sand and brown colors, and it's gonna tone down the other words. So everything looks like it's jumping off the wall back and forth.
Right, yeah, that's good.
Do you prefer fluorescent, LED? You know, what sort of do you like?
I prefer the full fit tubes. Yeah. They will give you everything. Now, we were discussing in the beginning that you have wildfire blue and white. It's optical white and invisible blue. These both will show up underneath LEDs. They will, all the other colors, your green, your yellows, your reds, will not show up underneath LEDs because they're not in the proper spectrum. Okay? But if you want anything that I discussed to show without having to buy special lights or anything like that, your 4 foot tubes, depending if you get, I prefer the T12s. You can get T12s all day long, that's the way to go. Even though your T8s are still 40 watt, they do not have the punch that a 4 foot T12 has. Okay? The only thing is, the reason why I would say is you can't strobe 4 foot tubes without killing them off, or the ballast in there. So if you sit there and have a decent strobe, that will kill off that. Now, the problem with LEDs in that situation is you can't make a strobe that will kill off the power of the LED. So if you want this effect, best to put in the 4 foot tubes.
solar power in it without killing off the black light.
Yeah.
Plus the typical xenons grow. Layering colors. Okay, here's the deal. 3D, in a nutshell. Red comes forward. Green sits in the middle. Blue recedes. Blue sits with black. Blue is neutral. Our minds see hot to cold. Okay? So when you have the 3D glasses on, they've been holographically etched on one side to emulate how your mind sees. So your reds are coming forward in any corresponding color down to green. People say, well, why not yellow? Because that's primary colors. This is because you're working on two primaries, one secondary. Okay? Yellow has a portion of red in it, so it will move forward up the spectrum. So your green will sit in the middle. So I can come along and produce red and then orange on the side, and then I can blend this and blend that. So if I have a hand coming out towards you and it's red, I can blend that down to blue. And it's going to look like it's hanging off the wall, especially if you put a drop shadow in. Which some people forget, it says, I don't care about the whole color spectrum. When you're having it, you're painting, you want to have the illusion to the customer that something's coming off the wall. Now, you get it with the 3D glasses, but if you have that drop shadow, saying my hand is actually elevated away from the wall, you're going to have a far better effect. Nice thing, too, is it's red in any corresponding color. Receding. So if we want to go through and create caves, all our caves are done in red or various shades of orange. Everything in the insides and blues, and it will look like it's 10, 12 feet deep. Especially if you sit there and say, I have blues in the back, and I want to do a slight outline in purple on the outside. Purple, because there's a portion of red sits in front of blue. Anything too, you can sit there and create rooms of green, rooms of red, rooms of blues, and they would all have different corresponding to that based on how much purple and how much blue. And so instead of saying, I'm going to go through my whole 3D maze and just do it all with the wild colors, maybe we'll have the first portions of the wild colors and then have some special rooms where it's various shades of yellow and green, various shades of reds and oranges. Or if we add in black to reds, we could have a rust room. Like, let's say, let's do a toxic room or a nasty bathroom in your 3D maze where we've rusted it because we've added portions of red into the black. But then if you have varying stages of it, like I had this jar, you know, and I had this much red, mixing the black, you're going to get all different levels, and that will translate to glasses. When you do a mixture of what we discussed before of a brown or a tan or any of that nature, the glasses will pick up how much red is in that paint, even though you can't see it. And you can create all the levels inside based on that. So if I sit there and say, I'm making all these different dirt tan colors, I've mixed in X amount of red or orange into these, and the 3D glasses will pick up as to what is what, and you don't have to do a lot to do it. And then detailing, not line work, shadowing. Stay away from the line work. Okay? We're given the illusion that something's in front of something else. And if you look at the human face, you look in the mirror and stuff, you are not made up of lines, you're made up of basic shadows. You know, somebody says, you know, I freak out when I draw from space and stuff like this. Don't even think about that. You are a grouping of shapes, and it's dictated by where the light is and shadow. So if you sit there and say, I'm creating this room, I want to give the illusion that this is in front of this, the glasses are going to help you with that as far as the colors. But then I want those drop shadows. I want this, you know, if my monster's coming through and he's got his arm like this, I want that drop shadow across his chest. Okay, and that is especially the fact there are certain clients that can't see 3D. There's something wrong with one eye, nearsighted. Sometimes the 3D glasses do not work, but they still can have a good time going through it because you created dimensionality, you know, with how you lay out your shadows and the detail.
So I got a question for you. So let's say you lay down towards your background, okay? And you got one of your, say you got a skull, okay? So now you highlight it with, say, red and orange.
So I got to get up and go.
Yeah.
I got to apologize for.
So green sits in the middle. Why do you do a lot of your legs?
Which is down. I got to go out there.
This is because, you know,
and through that,
I'm a rule breaker.
I can't see
the green coming through with drips or drool or snot or whatever. It says it messes with glasses. Some of my highlights I do in yellow, because a lot of times you want to do highlights with a higher up corresponding color. So let's say you want to make your red
shining.
Okay, buddy. Okay, I appreciate it. If you're gonna be around, chit-chat. Okay. I like my stuff to look shiny and wet. So you highlight a lot of your, we don't want to create like Spencer's when I was a kid and had the guy go over the moon and the motorcycle and it's a black belt and it's red.
Oh boy.
Fuck fighting. And I was like, no, I want to have that look of I've been crawling through the sewer, I got this and that. So a lot of times your yellows can be highlighted. In the past, I used white wildfire with a paintbrush or something. You can't spray it. But it screwed around with the glasses so much that we went with yellow. Or, like for red areas, I'll mix a little red in with the yellow so you're not so much heavy, like in depth. It's just another highlight coming at. So, you know, the other thing too, when you're doing eyes, make sure there's a reflection in the eyes. Most of the time, people in the UV, they don't see a reflection in the eye, but let's pretend that you're not painting UV. And the reflection in the eye, that just creeps people out. The site I just did over in Jewel City, Jewel, over there, you know, the eyes, make sure the reflection in the eyes just freaks people out. Way back when I used to do laser tag units, and that's when we run around with a gun, they could run around with people eyes staring at them, all the Miami pipes coming out of it, and a big old reflection, and just freaking red out.
Does like perma-wet or varnish or something else give a wet look in that scenario? Or
no, because the black lights won't allow it. Yeah. Since it's how it's airbrushed.
Yeah.
Okay. But here's the glory. Dayglow mixed with mask paint. So if you want to paint your latex masks, wipe them down with denatured alcohol, make sure they're clean. And you're able to mix in Dayglow, which I do in 80-20, 20% paint, 80%, well actually 10% paint, 70% latex, and 10% water. And I put a first coat on the mask with the automotive gun. Now it's gonna go on pastel, you're gonna like, eek, gross, you know? But it will dry down to the existing color. And then you're,
I'm sorry, 10% paint, 10% water.
And 70% mask latex. That way you're able to take your masks that you want for the thing and paint them up, and it would be a permanent application.
It was 10-10-70?
Yep.
What was the last 10?
10 water, 10 paint, 70% latex.
It was 9.
10, 20%. Whatever. Yeah, you can just figure it. It's like, wait, 70? 10, yeah, okay. 80%, yeah, I go 80% latex, 10% water, 10% paint. Okay.
No, it's latex mask making or slurry latex.
Any latex you got, go work. Okay, but now I don't know about silicone. I do not mess with silicone.
So how much PSI did you say?
70.
Hey, when you were talking about doing the murals on the Muslim, okay? So you say these can be folded or whatever. When you fold them, do you get creases in them?
Yep.
Creases
in the and they paint? Fall out.
Okay.
Because the paints we're using are acrylic, so basically liquid plastic.
Yeah.
Okay, and they will fall out. That way, we're able to do 70 pieces for somebody and ship it to them for $100 in a box versus having to pay freight. You know, because we're doing 8x10s, 8x20s, 8x30s. Fold them up in a box, wrap them in plastic, and ship away.
No, but what I'm saying is, like, does the paint fall off?
No.
We increase them.
No, I was saying I got 15, 20 years of canvases out there.
Okay.
Yeah, it does not. Because the way I'm doing it is it's shooting through the fiber.
Oh, okay.
Okay, even when I'm using, when I paint t-shirts, I'm using Rust-Oleum on t-shirts. Painted up there dry, permanent, it's not going anywhere. And a lot of times with these canvases, acrylic, it's shooting right through. I mean, you can actually see almost a duplicate of the piece on the back side. Somebody asked me, can you paint both sides? No, you can't, you know, and they go.
And when you're doing t-shirts, what are you shooting at through? Is that still 70?
Yeah.
Do you do the base
color for the t-shirts, or are you just shooting
right there?
No, just.
Hey, do you do black t-shirts?
Black with white, flat black or stolen.
Okay, so you put a base of white down?
Yeah, but I also can do negative positive and do ghosted.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All the questions. I think we just want to say thank you, Stuart, for the seminar. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, people. Appreciate it.
We swear by him here. So if anyone wants to talk to him privately, I'm sure he'd be more than willing to.
Is there any of your work?
Any questions? If there's anybody who doesn't want to wait until 8 p.m. to do the walkthrough, I'll go through with you guys now if you'd like to. If anyone would like want to do that. But I don't want to confuse with the next seminar, which I think is at noon.
There you go, people. That was my first seminar here, and that was the 11 o'clock. I hope you learned something. Sorry about the sound, and the Husky gun gets acquired at Home Depot, not Lowe's, just FYI. Thanks for watching, people. Please subscribe. More coming. Hot escape room action coming soon. Take care.